good to have you in our service this morning. I trust you feel good. The air out there is a little crisp this morning, and so give us a hint of fall to us. So we're glad that you're here and want you to enjoy being in the service as we serve the Lord and enjoy worshiping Him today. As you look at your bulletin, you'll see the things that are going on there. I'm not, again, going to reread all your bulletin. I am going to draw you down to the bottom of the middle column, and it says Harvest Supper. That's 2 weeks from yesterday. Will be our Harvest Supper. We want to invite you to come. Hopefully you will enjoy that. And we've got a treat for you, or at least for the smaller ones. Candy has volunteered to put a horse corral up on the property across the street and bring a couple of her horses. And for any of the little ones, I don't know who Candy defines as little ones, but whoever the little ones, Charlie, I'm not certain me and you are going to be in the little ones, but anyhow, every time I go to a horse to get to mount up on him, he runs away. I don't understand, but anyhow. All righty, and so for bring your littles. I haven't talked with Candy yet, and set up exactly when she's going to do it. We'll have that done. Me and her talked about it between services, so I can tell you this is a breaking news story. All right, yeah, so but you can we'll have that planned, and the little ones, several of them said they want to ride horses, including my little blonde headed little one back there. So maybe this will be her an opportunity to do so. So look forward to that on Harvest Supper. With that coming up for us. You see the other activities that are there. Be involved in them as much as you can. I've got our monthly newsletter from the Georgia Southern crew. And of course, Justin is who looks after that for us, is on the staff, and he writes for us. I say Justin, Stephen, is the one who looks after that for us, and he has sent you a letter so you can see what's going on. One of the things, I'm not going to read the whole letter to you, but he said they have seen one student come to know Jesus as their Savior this past month, so that's a good work that's going on, and others becoming involved in disciples. So good things happening there. And just as an aside, we do have a work here or in Albany at Darton University that's going well. If you want to be involved in that, there's ways to be. It's ending for this time. It'll start back up after the year, and they need help, or he needs help in things like meals for the students and that type of thing. So there's opportunities for us to be involved in there. If you haven't picked your October bulletin up, it's on the back, back there on the table, and it has information. If you'll get information, it tells you how to do it in the bulletin to Melissa or to Miss Linda. They will add it to it. If you would like to put your birthday down, you know, it might be important for somebody to know your birthday, or whatever. You want to put something in the calendar that pertains to the calendar, let them know, and they'll be glad to do that for you. And we are trying to grow. And of course, I know this morning we've got a good many folks away for different reasons, but we're trying to grow. Our Sunday school enrollment is 103. Of that, we found 69 of them this morning. So that means they were 34 missing in action. And so if one of your fellow classmates or teachers for your students was absent, be sure and try to contact them and let them know that you missed them. Don't call them up and say, where were you? Have you, you know, backslid and all. Just call them and say, we missed you. And look forward to seeing you next Sunday. And we'll be praying for you if there's something we can pray for you about. So that's an opportunity to be there. Well, we are glad that you're here. We're going to spend just a few moments and let you stand up. Visit those around about you. If you're guests in our service this morning, we want to say thank you. We're glad that you're here. We're going to all stand up, and someone will find you and shake your hand as we stand and fellowship one with another. deacons on Sunday mornings to come before us and talk with you about our building fund and our building, and to share with you their hopes and dreams and anything that they choose to do so. Our first deacon is going to come to you, and we'll be doing one a Sunday morning, not all of them every Sunday morning, as our chairman of the deacons for this year. And so I've asked Stacy if he would come and share our petitions. You see, we started last week. We had $13.51 start off, so we only got a few more dollars to get to $100,000.
Good morning. We got a long way to go to get to $100,000. Now, I've been thinking all week since Preacher mentioned this past week. I've been thinking all week of trying to come up with something inspirational to say, you know, on the tractor this week. Just been thinking, trying to get something to you know, really pour. And I'm at a loss for words, to be honest with you. And I come up here and I can say anything you want to say. But can we do it by ourselves? No. Can God do it by himself if he wanted to? Yes. But God don't want to do it by himself. He wants us to do it with his help. And that's all there is to it. You know, a lot of you don't, with the building committee meeting and the deacon meeting and stuff like that, if all of you knew some of the things that had happened, that it fell into place when we didn't know where we might turn to next, it sends chills up your spine of how God's worked. When the pastor going to a meeting that he didn't really, really, really want to go to, that he really, really, really didn't have time to go to, and put him down beside somebody that his first impression was, I just don't like this fella. You know. And that fella turned into somebody that got the ball rolling on something else. Next thing you know, they're good friends. Just stuff like that just fell into place. Little bit by little bit by little bit. And that ain't nothing but God working. There ain't no other explanation for it. How many of you would take $5,000 for your car sitting in the parking lot right now?
I didn't bring the right car.
Wait a minute, I'll go home and get it, all right?
I just walked around the parking lot just a second ago. The car's sitting in the parking lot. How many of you would like to take a gander how much money just sitting in cars in the parking lot? If you took $5,000 for each car that's sitting in the parking lot, there's $350,000 sitting right out there in the parking lot. Just $5,000 for each car sitting in the parking lot. Well, you say, well, $350,000, that's a lot of money. It is a lot of money. I'm not saying that it's not. Is it doable? Yes. We got it sitting in the backyard right here, a little bit at a time. But it's going to take everybody in this church to do it. Can't take one person to do it. It's going to take all of us to do it. And I said it before, and when the last Gideon was speaking, I got up and said a little piece for them. We stood back, sit back, let them take prayer out of our schools for the kids. We sit back and let them take prayer away from anything that they're doing. We sit back now, and we just letting everything just take over gradually. Everything just taking over gradually. Anything bad, we sitting back, we letting it take over gradually. This is one thing that you can stand up and say, I'm doing this for God, but I'm also doing it for my kids and doing it for somebody else's kids. And my grandkids, this is something that you can ride by one day and say, well, I give money to that. That is my church. That is God's church. But that over there is just going to be a building. We say it's a church. But that over there is just a building. You are the church. You are God's people. Now it's time for us to act like God's people. We always say we want to do something for it, but we never have the opportunity to do it. Now's your opportunity to step up and act like God's children. Our sign started off from the beginning, building on faith. Now, I don't know the exact numbers, but when this deal started, I'm going to say we're going to be somewhere in the $600,000 range. between $500,000 and $600,000 that this church has already raised since this deal started. Now, when all this come about, could you see this happen? Nope. I can remember when we built the little addition over here on the side. I think we've done between $40,000 and $50,000, wasn't it? That was a big deal. And when we got through with it, we wrote a check for it, didn't we? That same thing gonna happen to us over here if we let God work in us. That's the same thing that'll happen over there. It'll be the same thing. I can remember sitting on the back row, Mr. Walter Powell, still alive, Mr. IJ, EJ Kilcrease, I can't think of the others, Mr. Lester and all them. I can remember when we built the annex over here on the side, over here. I'm not 100% sure, but I want to say it was $20,000 to build an annex. Do you know Mr. Robert right offhand? I don't know why that stuck out my money, but stuck out my mind, but I was sitting on the back row right there with Josh on Wednesday night when they passed it. And I'm thinking, you know, I'm 15, 16 years old. I said, these people have gone crazy. I said, how is this little church going to raise $20,000 to put in an annex just so we can eat? If I'm not mistaken, when we got through with it, I think the check was wrote for it right there on the spot. And that's the way this church has grown. Has any of y'all ever seen the picture of this church when it was first done, when it first come up? That's how this church has grown to what it is now. That's why we're having to get across the road to have more room. We have faith in God. But to have faith in God, we have to have people to have faith in God. And that's where you come in. Thank you.
Thank you, Stacy. Appreciate that. All right. Turn to number 8, 9, and 10. All right, there's going to be some directions here. Number 8, you sing the first, second, and fourth verses. See the little pointy arrow? That means the verse you sing. Linda's going to play a little dilly there. We're going to turn to page 9. Then you're going to sing the first and second verses. Linda doesn't play a dilly between 9 and 10. We just go straight into 10. Now, down there, two lines from the end, there's going to be one measure nobody's going to sing unless you'd like to sing a solo this morning. So, don't sing a solo. And y'all know these songs, so let's all sing. 8, 9, and 10.
of Philippians. Philippians chapter 3. Go to the end of your Gospels. Go across Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians. You will come to Philippians. If you get to 1st, 2nd Timothy, Hebrews, you've gone too far. You need to turn around and come back. Philippians chapter 3. Sunday mornings in our morning scripture reading, I try to find things that pertain to the message, and most of the time they do, and this Sunday morning is certainly no exception. We'll be preaching out of the book of Acts, but the city of Philippi and what happened there will certainly be on the front part of our message, so listen as this will pertain as we begin to preach here directly. Paul writes for us and says, "Finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed is not grievous, but for you it is safe. Beware of dogs, beware of evil workers, beware of the concision. For we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit, and rejoice in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinks that he has whereof he might trust in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee. Concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. What things were gained to me, I counted as loss for Christ. Yes, doubtless, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them as waste, that I might win Christ. And have found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of faith by God, that I may know him, and the power of his resurrection, and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brothers, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth into those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many be perfect, be this minded, and if anything be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us have the same thing, let us mind the same thing. Brothers, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as you have us for an example. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, whose glory is their shame, who mind earthly things. For our manner of living is in heaven, from where we also look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. Children of God responded.
Amen.
Stacy, will you lead us in prayer?
Father, we thank you for the day you granted to us. We're just thankful for being able to come out this morning to learn more about your word. Pray that you give our pastor the word to say that might save the nearest one to eternity. Help us all to put the sermon in our hearts. Be able to get through this world and the times that we have, trials and tribulations. Lord, just thank you for the things that you have blessed us with beyond our wildest measures. Lord, just pray for the ones on the prayer list, the ones that have been mentioned this morning, the sick, afflicted. Pray to heal back and much one of will and health. Father, we talked about our building fund. Lord, we know that our church across the road is not our church, it's your church.
Yes.
Lord, we just know that we're just part of the equation.
Yeah.
Just pray that you bless it in your own special way. Pray for the ones who are doing the work on it, from the ones that poured the concrete to the ones that's going to be erecting the building. Lord, just pray that we can have a part out there to say that we glorify your name in everything that we undertake to do.
Yeah.
Thank you for the rain and sunshine you've blessed us all with. Pray for the ones who are a lot less unfortunate than we are. Just pray that you'd help them through their trials and tribulations, their everyday walks of life.
Children, if you will come down to meet Josh, meet him at the front.
How are y'all today? Y'all sound pretty excited to be here. Good morning. Yeah, that's a little bit better. How about that? Does that brighten your day up a little bit? No. Yeah. Well, I kind of brought it to talk about something that you guys probably don't know a lot about yet, but maybe a little bit. Have you ever, any of you guys ever bought a toy or a present with your own money? Have you done, yeah? Yeah, did you know, had you noticed that if a toy costs $5, when you get up to the cash register, you have to pay like $6 for it? Although it says $5 on the tag right there, you get up to the register and it costs you a little bit more money. Have you ever noticed that? Well, it does. It does. Yeah, they tack on a little bit of money, and what they call that is taxes. Yeah, we pay sales tax on everything that we buy, and we pay a lot of us, we work and we pay income tax. We pay a lot of taxes. Y'all know where that tax money goes? It goes to the government. Yep. And they use it for different things, different funds throughout our country. But, you know, sometimes folks think it's a little unfair that we have to pay our money to the government. Would you think that's kind of unfair that you go to pay for a $5 toy and you have to pay $5.50 or $6 for it? Wait till you have to buy a $30,000 vehicle. Yeah. Or something along those lines. Well, you know what? There's a story came up in the Bible about taxes. Somebody asked Jesus about taxes. And, I forgot to mark it. Y'all bear with me just a second. Yeah, it's right here. It comes out of Matthew chapter 22. And you know what? Somebody kind of asked Jesus if he felt like they should be paying taxes. And I want to read this story to you. Y'all ready? It says, "Tell us therefore," and these folks are talking to Jesus, "what do you think? Is it lawful for us to give tribute, pay our taxes unto Caesar or not?" Now, what do you think Jesus might have had to say about that? Any guesses? All right, well, this is what he said. He said, "Show me your money." And they handed him some money like this dollar right here. And he said, "Whose image is on this money?" Anybody know who that is on that dollar? Just blurt it out if you know who it is. It's George Washington, kind of the founder of our country, right? Yep. Of course, in those days, their money had Caesar's name or Caesar's picture on it. So everybody answered, and they said, "Well, it's Caesar's." And this is what Jesus said. He said, "Render, give to Caesar what is Caesar, and give to God what is God's." All right. You ready? Let's get serious for just a second. Sometimes we have to pay things to the government because we owe them money. All right, that's a tax. It's part of living in this country. We all try to come in, we help out to pay different bills for the country and things like that. We owe our government certain taxes. But let me ask you something. What do we owe God? What do we owe God? You ever thought about that? Jesus came down, he lived a sinless life, and he died on the cross for our sins to save us and give us an eternity in heaven with him. What does that draw from us? What do we owe him for that? How about this? How about everything we are? Our entire lives. You know what? You can't buy anything in this country. You can't buy anything without presenting your money first. I've never been to Lowe's or Walmart or Home Depot and said, "Can I have this right here? And I promise you I'll pay you back over the next 70 years of my life." I've never said that. Has that ever happened to you guys? It don't work that way, does it? But it does when it comes to Jesus. Jesus didn't require any payment from us when he came down. He came down out of love. And he gave us his present, his gift first, the gift of eternal life. And you know what? After we accept that gift of eternal life, we can pay him back with our lives. We can give our lives to Jesus. And we can work for him, pray for him, tell others about Jesus. And I don't think we'll ever pay him back. You know what? The gift that he gave us is way too big for us to ever pay him back for it. But we can try. And we can do that by showing him how much we love him. Okay? So this is what I want you to do. Everybody ready? As you go through life, the next few years, when you go to pay your taxes, and it makes you mad, this is for everybody. All right? Think about the free gift that Jesus gave us and what we can strive to do to pay him back for it. Okay? All right, let's say a prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day, God. Lord, we thank you for this country that we live in, God. And Lord, we're happy to pay our taxes in this country and do our part to help out, God. And sometimes we get a little frustrated because we may not like where our money goes. But, Lord, in the Bible, you tell us to give to Caesar what is Caesar's, Lord. Give to America, the United States, what is theirs. Give to our government what is theirs, God. And give to you what is yours. And, God, I just pray that you'll help us give our lives to you, God. It's yours anyway. You bought it with a price, and you came down, Lord, and you gave us a gift without requiring anything on our part except to accept it, God, just to take it. And, Lord, just I pray that you'll help us try to pay you back, although we never can. Help us to live our lives to show you how much we love you and how much we appreciate it. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Hymn number 774. 774, let's all stand.
Yeah.
Charlie and choir, musicians and sound persons for that. Good leading us in singing, and then of course come thy fountain, a traditional and a non-traditional way. It's good. We enjoy that good music. As you turn to the book of Acts, chapter 16, let me tell you that last Thursday we met First Baptist Church in Leesburg for our annual Mallory Association meeting. We are 51 churches now and mission strong. We came together to celebrate what God is doing in the midst of our Tri-County area. And so God is doing many good things. We were led in worship by a young person's group, the Voices of Truth, from Bruton Parker College. I believe there was 10 of them, two guys and girls then, and just did a tremendous job singing. Wonderful young folks. Brother Roy leaned over to me and said, "Don't you really love that harmony?" And I said, like I know what harmony is. That's good. But they were singing good, so it sounded good to me, and I agreed with Brother Roy. So it was very good. And then George Russ brought us a message and told us a lot about what's going on in New York City. And we have a part to play in that ministry from our headquarters there, the building. You can put a pin and draw a mile. It's a 75-mile radius, and there's 22 million people in that area of every sort you can imagine. And they are reaching them. They have 250-something churches in that one association. Not all their churches look like our church. Some of them are meeting in houses. Some are meeting in little storefronts and different things. People of all kinds of races. One thing that he said and that I like is that is God is urbanizing our world, bringing them into huge cities, so at least they'll have an opportunity to hear the gospel if we're faithful in preaching the gospel to them. So rather now than necessarily having to go to the four corners of the world, God brings the world to us. And we need to be faithful in preaching that word to them. So we do both things. We try to minister to them here and then go across the world and reach those we can. I just didn't have time today to talk a whole lot about it, but wanted to let you know we have six of our folks, I think, go and big delegates to the association. It's a wonderful thing. You need to know that you're involved in more than just what this work is doing. By cooperating with our Baptist churches and some non-Baptist churches we try to cooperate with in our area and across the world, you do have a part in spreading the gospel all across this big globe we live on. All right, if you found your place, the book of Acts, chapter 16, I'm not going to read the whole chapter, but I'm going to tell you the story that goes with it, but I'm going to pick up reading in verse 16 and read the remainder of the chapter. So if you'll find Acts chapter 16, if you found that in your copy of Scripture, would you please stand and honor the Word of God as I read for us this morning. Luke records for us, "It came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination," and this is a medium or a soothsayer or a palm reader, that type of person, "met us, which brought her masters much gain with her soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, 'These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show us the way of salvation.' And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, 'I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her.' And he came out the same hour. And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains were gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers and brought them to the magistrate, saying, 'These men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans.' And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates tore off their outer garments and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely, who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, waking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, 'Do not harm yourself, for we are all here.'
Then he cried for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you shall be saved in your house. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his, straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, he set meat before them and rejoiced, believing in God with all his house. And when it was day, the magistrate sent the sergeant, saying to let those men go. And the keeper of the prison told this saying to Paul, The magistrate sent to let them go. Now therefore depart and go in peace. But Paul said unto them, They have beaten us openly, uncondemned, we being Romans, and have cast us into the prison. And now do they thrust us out privately? No, but let them come themselves and get us out. And the sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. And they came and besought them and brought them out and desired them to depart out of the city. And they went out of the prison and entered into the house of Lydia. And when they had seen the brethren, they comforted them and departed. The children of God responded. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. I want to tell you this story that we have before us. It's an extremely important story in the beginning of the Christian faith. It covers a lot of ground and teaches a lot of things. And, of course, I'm not going to cover all of them this morning. There's really one thing I want to get to when we get the story told. We are living, if you haven't noticed, in very difficult and uncertain times. It is beyond my comprehension to believe that in my lifetime that the morals and the religious atmosphere of this once great country has declined to the place that it is today. I have preached the great part of my preaching ministry, which now is over 30 years of preaching, about the decline of America, about the decline of morals, and honestly, in most of my preaching, while we say we know it's at hand, I really, in my mind, thought those things would happen in another generation, that I would not live to see what we see before us today. But before us today, we see a society that is totally degenerated. You say, well, preacher, we've got more than we've ever had. That does not mean that your society is a moral society. We live in one of the most immoral countries in all the world. We do. I hate to say that, but we do. One of the evidences of that is this past week. One of our cities, our southern cities, in one of our most conservative states, Texas, has elected a mayor. And that mayor is an openly active homosexual. She's a lesbian. And she has set forth a path to exclude anyone that has different views and ideas. As a matter of fact, she says that anyone that does not believe like she believes are intolerant. I don't say you can make that statement with a straight face, because you're just saying you're intolerant of anybody that doesn't believe like you believe, but she says that anyhow. And in that state, she passed a law, or had in that town, Houston, she passed a law, had the council pass a law, stating that restrooms could no longer be denominated as men's or women's restrooms, but rather they would be generic restrooms, so that if you walk up to it today and you decide that you are no longer a man, but you today identify as a female, you can go into this one. And if you walk up to today and decide that you're no longer a female, but you're a man, you can go to this one. Or if you're one of the other varieties of all the initials of the alphabet in between. I want to tell you, folks, that is blatantly immoral. Unarguably immoral. A society that allows itself to be ruled by someone like that is a society that's lost its way. And we live in this from the highest echelons of government all the way down. I'll just bring that one up. The great atrocity the pastors in the area committed was they saw that as an affront to the morality of the Bible, and so they did what any good American should do. They stood up and said no. And they supported a petition that says, no, bathrooms ought to be for those that are alike. I hope this doesn't come as a great shock, and I believe I can say this with any member in this room here, young or old. Everyone comes into this world marked boy or girl. Now, if you need to know how, come to me after service, and I'll try to explain that to you. But having been now the father of four children, I can tell you I had no problem deciding what they were. We don't come into this world as other choice, something other than boy or girl. And so they did what we should do. They said, no, we are not going to open our young folks, especially up, to the perversion of society. And they served a petition. That petition had to receive 17,000 signatures to be put on the ballot for the people to vote. That's all they asked. Can we let our folks vote? Well, they think this is right. Now, they received over 55,000 signatures in the city of Houston to do so. So they well exceeded it. And the leaders, the powers that be in Houston, threw that out and said, no, we're going to have it the way we're going to have it. And then the mayor became enraged that anybody would think different than she does. And so she had her legal authorities send subpoenas to five pastors demanding that anything that had been said about her, been said about a gay person or a person of any of the other denominations there, or had mentioned this petition, that they would have to turn in their sermons. They would have to turn in their texts that they have on their phone about that, or emails on their computer, or any other written communication. That is a violation, by the way, of the First Amendment. All these other separation church and state are not true. There's nothing mentioned. But I don't tell you, the Constitution of the United States, by its First Amendment, directly forbids government to enter into the affairs of the church without question. And so we've seen the ensuing thing that goes on for that. And I want to, after telling the story this morning, I want to answer the question, how should we respond? How should we respond? I think it's vital that we respond appropriately, and I want to talk about that. Well, let's tell the story here before us, and let's deal with that issue this morning. Wonderful, wonderful event. Paul has been commissioned to be the missionary to the world, to the Gentiles, to us, to the non-Jewish folks. He was commissioned to go into the cities and byways of the world and present the gospel. He would go where at first, being a Jew himself, to the Jewish synagogue or where the Jewish folks were meeting. There, hopefully, he would find a hearing. He would present the gospel, and from there, God would send the Holy Spirit, and the church would be formed across the world. He was in the process of doing this. He had covered most of what we would call the Middle East now. His ministry had stretched up to the borders of modern-day Turkey, the northwestern borders, and God had sent him to the churches there. He had in his heart the desire to go past that over into what we would call the Western world, over into the metropolitan areas of thought and the things that were going on, into Rome and Greece and those areas. But the Holy Spirit constrained him not to do so. Each time he would try to make a plan to go that way, he would feel in his heart the impression from the Holy Spirit that it's not appropriate, not time to do. One night while he was on this missionary journey, it's been his second one, he went to sleep, and in the night, a vision came to him, and it was a man over in this area called Asia Minor, where today Greece and the countries there over into Rome were. And the man called out to Paul and said, "We need some help. Come on over here." Paul recognized it as a vision of God and God opening the door to the Western world. And so immediately the Bible says he got up the next morning, he made his plans, and in 2 days he was in Macedonia. We'll find if you read your Bible, it would take him 5 days to retrace those steps. But because God sent a favorable wind, it was the will of God. The Apostle Paul came over to the area there of Macedonia and says he went to the city of Philippi. Now, Philippi was a major city in the world that day. It had been founded many years before. It had several different names, but when Philip of Macedon, the Macedonian, came in that area. He took the city and gave it his name. Philip, of course, is the father of Alexander the Great. And he gave some prominence and importance to the city of Philippi. It grew some, became a prominent city. And later on, there was a great battle that was fought just north of the city of Philippi. It was fought between with Brutus and Cassius against Octavius. Octavius was the Caesar of Rome at the time, and Brutus and Cassius was trying to separate themselves and have their own little empire over there. And of course, Octavius could not allow that. So he sent the armies of Rome along with himself as emperor. There they had a great battle, and they defeated Brutus and Cassius, and then took over the city of Philippi, and it became a Roman province and a Roman colony. If you read the story behind this, you'll see it, but we don't have time to read all that, so I'm telling you the history. And I know some of you this morning, your eyes are already rolling up in the back of your head. You said, we didn't come to church for history. I want to tell you, history is important. You need to understand the context, and it's more important than that. When somebody asks you, how do you know your Bible is true? One of the ways you know that is when the Bible records history, it records accurate history. And when the things that it says are in the context of the time and the place, when folks go to authenticate ancient writings, the Bible and others, one of the things they look at, when the writer says things about an area, does he say things that are in context with the time, or does he do like most of us would do, we allow what we know today to pepper what we say? And so a true authentic writing would have written without other knowledge. And when you read the story here, you see that it's being written with the knowledge that that person in that day would have. And so when we see some of the things, I'm telling you this history, you'll be able to see that. So what it became was a Roman colony, a Roman province, and literally what happened is Roman soldiers, part of their retirement package was if they chose to, they could go and live in the city of Philippi and be a prominent member there and have a place there. So Philippi became a province of Rome with the military leadership. A lot of the hierarchy of military leadership would go and live in Philippi and be taken care of there. And because of that, it became a very proud town. They would walk around and they would say, we are citizens of Philippi. Now, all the surrounding country were not Romans. They were whatever country that Rome had conquered. And so they did not have the privilege of a Roman citizen. But these dear folks down at Philippi, they'd say, well, we are Romans, and we live under the rules of Rome, and we have a special place. And besides that, we fought in the great wars. And they'd go and tell you about all their great wars and all those things. They became philosophers and thinkers and general all-around know-it-alls. You know the folks I'm talking about, like most preachers. So this was the place that Paul was called to preach. So he went in there, and the first thing he did, he looked to see if there was a synagogue, and there was not a Jewish synagogue in the town. To have a Jewish synagogue there, you would have to have 10 Jewish men of good report that would form a synagogue, and there they would meet in assembly and remember the things of Israel. Well, evidently in this place, there was no such place. So Paul went to the next natural place he would go. And there's a Greek name for it, and I can't say it, so y'all go look it up if you want to. But it's where the Jewish folks would go meet down by the river and have a prayer meeting. And usually you would have one or two men with the women of the town that would have a prayer meeting. Well, then Philippi, because it was the Roman stronghold and all these officers were there, we find that there were no Jewish men, or at least there were Jewish men there. They didn't take their place. And so down by the river, we find a little prayer meeting that was led by a lady named Lydia. She was a prominent lady. She was a seller of purple, and she was from the place called Thyatira. If you read your Bible, if you read over into the second and third chapters of the book of the Revelation, you'll find one of the cities of the seven cities mentioned is the city of Thyatira, the city of purple. And so here she sold purple dye and purple clothing. Now, again, I don't have time because y'all don't want to be here, and your eyes will really roll back in your head if I do too much of this. And so purple was the color that the royals wore. Not everybody could afford the expensive dye. Again, you want to do some good Bible study, you know, go study how they got the purple dye. Man, that's a good story. And it's Jesus all over it. But I don't have time for that this morning because I want to get to the other part of the message. But that's just exercise for you. And so So she was a woman of prominence. She was a Jewish lady, and she was down there praying and doing what she thought was possible for her to have a relationship with her God. It's amazing how many times God worked with folks that are seeking for him. And so here comes along the Apostle Paul. He finds them there, and he tells them the good news of the story of Jesus Christ. And they become saved. And here's a place I want to stop for just a second, because I believe this is one of the places that the church has forgotten. We are in the business. We don't mind telling folks they're sinners, and we don't. Well, we do, but that's our message. And that they need to be saved from their sins and be baptized and live for God. But we forget to tell them the best part of the story, the goodest part. I know that's not correct English, but goodest part of the story is here, is that we serve a Savior that came to this earth, that God said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God infused in human flesh the very deity, the divinity of God Almighty. God took a perfect human being in the womb of Mary, and that he infused himself within that little embryo, and he was God in the flesh dwelling among us. He lived among us for some 33 years. He taught the perfect principles of God, and then the world despised him and nailed him to an old rugged cross, and there on the day of judgment of Passover, he was crucified, and he died for our sins, a horrendous, horrible death, paying a price Josh talked about that we could not pay for ourselves on the cross of Calvary. And then on the third day, hallelujah, Jesus Christ came back to life. I'm telling you, you've got the story to tell. This world has nothing to compare with. We believe that the God-man himself lived on earth, that he died, and then on the third day he kicked out the end of the tomb, stepped out of the grave, and said, I conquered that old thing. I'm alive. We serve a living Savior. We serve a risen Savior. We serve a powerful Savior. We serve a coming Savior. I want to tell you, the church sits back and tells the message of the gospel as a ho-hum message. I want to tell you, nobody else can tell that. Muhammad can't tell that. The Buddhist can't tell that. The Hindu can't tell that. The Baha'is can't tell that. No other religion has a living king serving us. Glory, hallelujah. We are the servants of the king, and he is alive. And so when Lydia heard that at the Lord, the Holy Spirit came to heart and changed her from an old hell-bound sinner to a heaven-bound saint. The power of the gospel to save. And we're afraid to tell it to somebody. Ought not to be so. And so Lydia got everlastingly, gloriously, hallelujah, saved. She didn't get Baptist saved. You know, oh yeah, preacher. Yeah, I need it. Yeah, I'm a bad boy. Okay. Dump me in the water. I'll be all right. I'll go sit on my pew and be quiet. Don't ask me to give you any money. I'll get mad at you and go to another church. No, she got glory. She said, you know what she said? I got a house over here. Why don't y'all come over here and stay with me? It was at least Timothy, Paul, and Luke here. Said, I got an extra room. I want to put you up. I want to look at you. I want to pay for your meals. I want to help you out in this. I believe in what you said. Jesus is alive. I no longer belong to me. I belong to him. What I have is his. Come take some of it. Doesn't sound like a Baptist, does it? We got to beg for a building fund. We got to do all these things. And Stacy was right. Only he's, as you could already tell, he's minorly wrong. There's no $5,000 car sitting out there. There's close to Josh's $30,000 car sitting out there. And you multiply that by that figure, and you're going to come up with millions of dollars worth of cars sitting out here on the front of the church. Amen? What does the Bible say about that? It says, where your heart is, that's where your money's going to be, isn't it? Y'all look like a bunch of cars then. When y'all come to church, we just go. I got to preach. It's just a too good spot tonight, at least. Wouldn't be a good preacher if I didn't. And so Lydia got gloriously, hallelujah, saved. invited them into their house, and they began to teach the message to other folks. And this damsel, this girl, this soothsayer, this medium, comes along, and she starts shouting behind them. This is the true God. They're teaching salvation. And did that for several days. After several days, the Apostle Paul got gloriously holy, perturbed, upset. Our King James says the word grieved. And so he finally got tired of it. God does not need the ways of the world, by the way, to do what God does. God doesn't depend on the medium. You know what the world does? They'll take the gospel. They'll see what they think they can get out of it, and they'll pervert it to fit themselves. They go along and make the gospel, make Jesus be the big Santa Claus in the sky, that every time you need something, you just reach up there and get you some. That's not the gospel, folks. And God doesn't need the help of the world system. God needs His people to do what He calls us to do. And Paul got good and tired of it. He turned around and said, had enough of it. Evil spirit, hit the road. And as all things do, they always do what the master commands, because it wasn't Paul saying it, it was Jesus saying it through Paul. And that lady came to her right mind. I'm telling you, listen, folks, when you get saved, you get your right mind. What's wrong with America? We got a bunch of lost folks doing what lost folks do, and we need to tell them they need to get in their right mind. And the only way for them to do that is come to know Jesus. And so she gets gloriously saved. And you would have thought folks around her would have been happy, because now she thought straight. But there was folks that were making money on her, making a good living on her. And they got mad. And by the way, you could see from the writing of the scripture, these must have been some folks of some prominence, because they bring Paul and Silas up before the magistrates, the leaders, and they said, these folks are teaching things they ought not to teach. Now, there were folks that followed around in the city that was stationed, probably ex-military folks, called lectors. And they carried huge bundles of rods with an axe-looking instrument in the middle of it. And they were ready to execute judgment when the magistrates told them to do so. That tells me there was a lot of judgment going on if they needed folks walking around with rods and stuff. You probably wanted to live like they wanted you to live in Philippi, else you got in trouble. They dealt with the trouble anyhow. And so the magistrate said, they're doing what? They tore off their outer garment. They sentenced them, and they told the lector there, get your rod. And they got rods, and they beat the tar. I know that's not in the King James, but they beat the tar out of Paul and Silas. They told the jailer, lock them up tight, we'll deal with them again. So the jailer, which was a retired, most likely, Roman soldier, very proud man, a man that took his job serious, he took them into the inner part of the dungeon, the dirty, damp dungeon, and put them in stocks. Now, I'm sure you remember from your American history of folks being put in stocks, but their stocks were a little different from the American history stocks. These were meant to exercise the most torture you could get to somebody and not kill them. They would pull their legs as far apart they could do and not split you open, and your arms as far apart as they could, and to cause your muscles to cramp and hurt and ache. If you ever, in the middle of the night, turned your foot the wrong way or your leg the wrong way and got a good old-fashioned cramp in your leg, and you started to jump around and holler, and your partner thought you got the Holy Spirit, and really it was just a cramp. That's what you were there, and you had that cramp, but you couldn't reach down there and rub it. I mean, they were exercising a number one penalty on you. When you left Philippi and you'd been in jail, you knew you didn't want to come back to that jail. I've got some things I can say about that, but y'all don't have the time. So they put Paul and Silas there, and the Bible says about midnight, Paul and Silas began to sing the praises of God. Now, if it had been old Bruce in the cell there, I know what Bruce had been singing. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying. That'd been me. I don't know what Paul and Silas were singing, but I know what they were singing about. They were singing about Jesus. You know how I know? Because it says these other folks was listening. They were hearing what was being sung here. And so that they were praising God in the midst of their trouble. Isn't that amazing? As they were doing so, heaven heard from its choicest saints. The Father and the Son looked over the walls of heaven and said, "Now, there are two saints. They're two of my children." Wouldn't fit the mold of most of our modern day preachers that sit in the ivory towers and preach that if you get health and wealth and prosperity and brush your teeth every morning so you can smile and shine at folks, everything's going to be all right. Just asking God to give it, He owes it to you. We're here to, for God to serve us. I want to tell you, you're not here for God to serve you. You're not here because at some way you're worthy to be here. You're here because God loved you enough to drag you out of the mud and the mire that you was in and save you and give you a home in heaven where you didn't deserve it. That's the reason we don't have any power in salvation. We think we are what we do to our children. We think that's how God is. We've trained our children that way. We give our children everything. We dote and parade on them and talk about them and run them from every ball game to here and there and every pageant and every parade and everything, and we make them the center of our lives, and they grow up proud and arrogant and thinking they're the center of the world, and then one day they're going to look at mom and dad and say, "Well, that's what you told us." Hmm? And hearing amens. By the way, that's not the way it's supposed to be, parents. You're to teach your children that they are children of God, and they're little sinners. They need to come to know Jesus as their Savior. And they need to see that Jesus is the center of the universe, not them. This is all free. I'm not charging you any for this. Goodness, wish I hadn't done that. I can still think it's a quarter to fill. And so they got to singing the praises of God. God looked over the heavenly walls and looked down there, saw His choice servants, and He says, "Angel, go shake them up down there. Turn them loose." Angel came, and a great earthquake took place, earthquake like you've never seen, and it shook loose the very bonds and the stocks that were holding them, opened up the prison doors. And here's what I tell you. See, the Bible's accurate. If the Bible did not say this, you could say it's probably not true. It says that old jailer pulled out his sword, and he's finna fall on it. It was his pride. He was of Roman descent. He was given a task. And if he failed at that task, his pride was shattered, and he couldn't go on. But the Bible accurately reports that old jailer pulled out his sword and said, "Not on my watch. I'm going to die before I'll be brought up before and embarrassed before the magistrates. It was my job to keep them there, and I didn't." About that time, Paul calls out and says, "Hey, man, don't do it. We're all here. Not a one of us is gone." That proud Philippian jailer said, "Give me some light." They got some light and run down, and he counted them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How many had? Every one of them was there. He stood in amazement. He'd been listening to Paul and Silas. He'd heard the songs, and more than that, he'd seen the servants of God being servants of God. "I count it all joy," I read you in Philippians chapter 3, "when I suffer for Jesus." He wasn't having a pity party. He wasn't down there moaning in the groin. I'm going to tell you, if anybody had a reason to have a pity party, Paul and Silas had a reason. They'd been beaten with an inch of their lives. They'd been put in socks, stretched out there with their muscles aching and cramping, and yet they said, "I'm going to serve Jesus where I am." That ought to give some of you hope to sit out in the congregation and say, "Well, I don't know. I got to serve Jesus here. I'm sitting in this church, and that preacher preaches to 10, 15, 20 after sometimes." Well, just smile and serve Jesus where you are. Suffer for Him. Nothing wrong with that. Philippian jailer says, "I want some of what y'all got. What did I do to get saved?" I want to ask you, has anybody ever looked at your life and said, "I want some of what you got"? Hmm? Has anybody ever looked at our lives and said, "I want some of what they got"? This jailer, guess what? he got hilariously saved too. He got hallelujah shouting, Jesus filled, Holy Spirit led, saved. You know what he did? He turned to Mama and said, Mama, I want to tell you about somebody. He told Mama about Jesus, and they told the kids about Jesus, and they told the household servants about Jesus. And the Bible said, wound up, the whole house got baptized because the whole house got saved. Not because the jailer got saved, because he got saved and got a good dose of Jesus, and they saw it in him. You know the end of the story. I won't tell you that end. You've got it. So what I want to tell you then, how in this world, when our world is crashing around us, and I want to tell you, it's going to become more antagonistic towards you and us. The world is not going to like us more. They're going to like us less. It's coming, folks. Get ready. It's coming in our lifetime. The day is coming when they're going to say that I can't preach the way I preach. The first thing they're going to do is they're going to threaten you with taking your tax status away. And you know what I'm going to say to that, don't you? Too bad, too sad, take it. I don't preach for taxes. I preach for Jesus. Now, that's a bad thing. That shows our society's going a long way away from it all to do. But that's not going to stop this preacher from preaching. Then they're going to say, all right, you're going to have to start turning your sermons in. This is where I'm in good shape. You're going to have to start turning your sermons in so we can censor them before you preach. You know what they're going to have to do to me? They're going to have to turn me in because my sermons are up here. They're going to have to go down there, and then I'm going to have to be like Paul and Silas. I'm going to have to start jail ministry because they're going to ask me what I'm going to preach. I'm going to preach to them about like I'm preaching now. That's not going to make anybody happy, but they need to hear it. That's what our brothers in Texas said, by the way. Our sermons are on our website. They have websites. Our sermons on our website. You do you good. Go listen at them. They're not hidden. We're not trying to hide anything. You just can't stick your fingers in here. How should we respond? I want to tell you, here it is, and I'm going to close. You get this, and I'm done. If I see in your eyes the light come on, we're done, all right? If you look this old dead, I'll have to go back and explain it all. And that's not good. Okay? Paul and Silas looked through Jesus' eyes at the matter. We heard George Russ say that, didn't we? I said, he's stealing my sermon. That's what I'm going to talk about. See, they were not looking through Paul and Silas's eyes at the matter. They was looking through Jesus's eyes. And Jesus said, if they hated you, they're going to hate. If they hated me, they're going to hate you. You can expect it. But guess what? If you will suffer in my name, through your suffering, I'll cause glory to come. And so he told them, when I call on you to suffer, suffer. Paul could have got out of this, by the way. All he had to do when they grabbed him before the magistrate, I'm a Roman citizen. That ended the matter. But he was being sensitive to the Spirit of God, and God called on him to suffer. And he called on and he suffered gladly. What we need to be careful of as this world presses, and it could be very easy to get mad at the mayor of Houston, and very easy to say derogatory things. I've heard some Christians saying some derogatory things. I want to tell you, folks, the only thing that lady needs is Jesus. She's a lost sinner. And we need to pray for her, not just those pastors out there. As a matter of fact, we need to pray for her more than those pastors. Those pastors know about it. All she needs is Jesus. We need to change our attitude about things and start looking at them through the eyes of Jesus. And it's amazing, you can have mercy and compassion on folks you thought you could never have mercy and compassion on when you quit looking at what's happening to you and look to Adam through the eyes of a Savior that said, for God so loved the world. And as far as I can tell, that lady's still part of the world. We need to be careful. I know today, many of you, and me including, sometimes get very upset with what our government does, even to the highest levels of the presidency of the United States, and do things that I think are absolutely ungodly and wrong, and it's easy to get mad and spout off and say things. I want to tell you to do that. You're looking through your human eyes. You're looking through your own being. What we need to do is turn around and see it through the eyes of Jesus, and we have the opportunity to love people when they're unlovely. I want to tell you, doom your testimony when we crack off and say vicious, ugly things about our government when it does these things. Yes, most of what they're doing today is ungodly. And yes, we ought to stand for godliness. But I want to tell you, we ought to have the personality of Jesus when we do it. And so when we look at these matters, we ought to do so in a kind, loving, firm, I don't mean to be wishy-washy. I don't mean to straddle the fence. But I want to tell you, we ought to do so with the love of Jesus in our hearts, because that's the only thing that's going to change the world. I don't want to hurt your feelings here, but I'm going to close with this. I want you to hear it. Your opinion doesn't matter. Did you hear me? Your opinion doesn't matter. You know what matters? It's what Jesus says. My Bible says, how can you claim to be a child of God and hate your brother or sister whom you have seen, and do not love your sister and brother that you have seen, but you claim to love God whom you haven't seen? I'll tell you, if you can't love that person that's unlovely here and pray for them and have a pleasant spirit about it, you need to check up and see which God you're serving. My God loves everybody. Does he tolerate sin? No. Does he love sin? No. But he loves people. Check our spirits, folks. Let's be men and women, boys and girls, godly. Let's love people that are unlovely. Let's pray for them. You say, well, I'm having a time praying. Well, let me say, you got something to pray about. You need to pray for the President of the United States of America, Barack Obama. If you don't pray for him every day, shame on you. And I don't mean pray that the Lord would kill him. I know some of you. That's ungodly. God puts folks in authority for his own reason. You need to pray that he'll have wisdom. I personally believe that you'd pray and get saved. Say, well, you don't have a right to comment on his salvation. Well, I just did. And if he wants my sermon notes, he can come get me and I'll give them to him. We need to pray for those people in our country. I am sick and tired of hearing people that are running for office talking ugly about each other the way they do. None of them deserve to be in office. Matter of fact, some of you need to run and take their places. But we need to pray for those folks. I'll tell you, you need to pray for that lady that's a woman that's mayor of Houston. You need to pray for her. You know what? There's a lot of Christians calling in saying obscene things to her. Did y'all know that? You know, folks, in the name of Jesus, it's calling her and saying all kind of evil things to her and saying all kind of hurtful things. I want to tell you, that is not godly. That is not godly. You know what she needs to know? That somebody loves her and cares for her. When you cry out of a prison, out of your pain and suffering, and in spite of that, you still love somebody, well, there's something that's irresistible about that. That'll change your heart. Have you prayed yet? God, would you cause me to suffer so somebody else can see Jesus? Well, let me warn you, don't pray that prayer unless you're ready to suffer. Not give me a new Cadillac. I'm not preaching that. Not increase my 401k. I'm not preaching that. I'm preaching, can we make a difference in the world in which we live in? Is this sweet music to your ears? Verse 25 says, and at midnight, Paul and Silas, beaten in stocks, prayed and sang, and out of them being crushed came the explosion of the blood of Jesus on the whole family. I want to tell you, if you could step into heaven and ask Paul and Silas now, was it worth it? They'd look at you and say, shut your mouth. I'd do it any time. Father, speak to our hearts. We are so light to respond with anger and malice and hatred for those that offend our view and ways of life. pray you would change us into creatures like Jesus, folks more like Paul and Silas of all. That it wouldn't be about us, it was about you. We'd learn to trust you, and Father, if you choose to crush us, we'll believe that you're going to pour out of our beings, out of our pain and suffering, the blood of Jesus on the lives of people that need to see that we believe in you enough that we'd even die for you. Help us in this dark age to be lights shining that others can see Jesus. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand and sing.